Okay, so we've talked about several different things related to a steady coordinated turn. We've talked about how to find the climb angle, the climbing rate, how to find the maximum bank angle, how to find the turning radius, and how to find the turning rate, as well as the maximum allowable turning rate. And we've talked also about the flight envelope, allowable flight envelope for an aircraft that's limited by both stall and structural damage. So now what I want to talk about is what happens if we have to worry about the effects of spanwise velocity effects. And by that, what I mean is differences in the velocity seen by different parts of the wing. So if you can imagine, let's say we have an aircraft, which I'll try to draw here, and it has pretty big wings. So think like your sailplane or U-2 or, you know, stuff like that. Maybe I'll shorten this wing a little bit so it looks a little more symmetric. Whatever the case, we have large wings. And let's say that we have this aircraft and it's in a tight turn. Okay, this is it. Now, this is exaggerated, of course, but say the center of the turn is like right here. So you can imagine the aircraft has a tangential velocity, which we'll call VCG, or the velocity of the center of gravity of the aircraft. But there's going to be a velocity V outer and a velocity V inner, where outer is the velocity of the outer portion of the wing at the outer portion of the turn, and V inner is the velocity of the wing at the inner portion of the turn. So just from this diagram and thinking intuitively, you can see that we're going to have a much higher velocity on the outer, on the outboard portions than on the inboard portions. And in fact, your inboard portions are going to have very low velocity in this tight of a turn. Now the variation between these is linear. Okay, so as we move down, the velocity that is seen by each portion, each section of the wing is linearly changing. Okay, and we're going to describe that as V sub R. That's this function here. I'll draw it in blue. So this is V sub R, or excuse me, V of R. And that's going to be VCG times R over big R, little r over big R. So this is a linear function. Now, we already know what big R is. We already know what VCG is. Little r is going to be the distance from the point of interest to the center. Okay? That's little r. All right? So, in that case, then r inner is going to be big R minus B over 2 cos gamma, okay? So B over 2 is, let me just label this real quick. So this distance from wingspan to wingspan is B. That's our wingspan. You may be familiar with that nomenclature already, I guess. But let's draw our aircraft in bank here with wings like this. So here's our bank angle. And this is right here is B over 2. Okay? So if we had the center here, and this is R, then little r is going to be this distance. So little r then is big R minus b over 2 cos phi. See how that works? I hope this makes sense, because I'm going to move on. If you're not convinced, just take a look at this geometry and you'll figure it out. Okay? So that's our inner. Our outer, then, is by the same logic here, is going to be big R plus b over 2 cos phi. So if we want to know what the velocity at the inner point is, that's going to look like VCG times big R minus b over 2 cos phi divided by big R, which can be simplified to be just VCG times 1 minus b over 2r cos phi. And in a similar manner, the outer is just going to be VCG 1 minus b, whoops, 1 plus b over 2r cos phi. So that's pretty straightforward. Now, in order for stall not to happen, we've got to be careful, right? So as we turn, we have really low velocity here on the inner portion. And low velocity, so if you'll go back, I'm going to do this in yellow just because it's kind of a parenthetical thing, but CL is your lift divided by 1/2, excuse me, yeah, lift divided by 1/2 rho v squared SW. If your V gets really low, that's going to push up your lift coefficient really high. And eventually, if your V gets low enough, this is going to be greater than CL max. So we have to be careful about this low velocity at the inner portion. And in order to avoid stall, then we have to make sure that what's going on here is not exceeding our maximum stall limited load factor. So let's go back and say, so recall nmax for stall is going to be 1/2 rho v squared inner, right? To avoid stall, we're worried about that inner portion, w over sw CL max. Okay, and we know what V inner is, so let's plug in V inner. We get 1/2 rho V squared divided by W over SW, where this V is VCG, times 1 minus B over 2R cosine of phi max quantity squared times CL max. Now we're using all these max terms, right? Because we're trying to figure out what radius and such we have to have to avoid stall. So this is the very moment of that stall occurs. Okay. So let's also recall that N max can be written as 1 over cosine phi, cosine phi max, I should say. And also that R can be written in terms of the load factor as well. So V squared over G root N squared minus 1. If we take this equation for N max, and substitute R for this equation for R into our R and this equation for N max, then we can rewrite this equation, putting everything on one side as N max. Okay, so sorry, let me just be a little more clear. We're taking all this stuff, we're plugging it in here. Okay. And then we're rewriting. So let me sub in. Okay, so now we rewrite, and what we get is this minus bg over 2v squared times root n max squared minus 1 minus root 2w over sw divided by rho v squared cl max times root n max cubed, all equals 0. Okay. So sorry, I'm getting a little bit messy here, but what we did is we replaced our cosine of phi max using this expression. We replaced our r using this expression, and then we rewrote everything. We rearranged everything to get this bottom expression. And I didn't go through all the details. If you feel uncomfortable with what I've done here, I encourage you to go through this all the details here. Okay. So n max can also be written in terms of the load limit. NPLL times W max over W. So if we sub that in here, then what we get is V squared minus square root 2NPLL W max over SW divided by rho CL max all times V minus BG divided by 2 times square root 1 minus W over NPLL W max quantity squared. It's all underneath the square root there. That equals 0. All right. So now we have this expression that includes our stall limited load factor and our structural limited load factor here. And if we find the roots of this equation, that gives us the minimum, or the airspeed, I guess. So what we're going to do now is we're going to find the roots, well, one of the roots of this equation, and that's going to be a velocity, okay? And that velocity then, the velocity that makes this equation true is the airspeed that allows a minimum turning radius. Okay, taking into account variation in velocity. Okay, so I'm not going to do that here. It's something that you can do. You'll notice this is a quadratic equation. But just skipping to the end, we get V R min, which is the full airspeed that gives you that allows the minimum turning radius, that without stall or structural damage. Anyway, that equals this. NPLL W max divided by SW divided by 2 rho CL max plus square root of NPLL W max over SW divided by 2 rho CL max plus BG over 2 square root square root 1 minus W over NPLL W max. That quantity squared. Whew, there you have it. This is the velocity that allows minimum turning radius with no stall, no structural damage. Okay. So now I want to remind you, this is only for the case where you have a tight turning radius and large wings, okay, where the spanwise variation of velocity is significant. For the majority of aircraft, the turning radius is large enough that spanwise variation in velocity does not matter all that much. Okay, this would be in the case of, like, for example, like a glider with really high wingspan and an extremely tight turn. Okay, and in this case, if you exceed, if you were to exceed the maximum lift coefficient on the inner portion of the wing and stall it there, it would induce a spiral, which could be very dangerous. Okay, so it's important that we know what this airspeed is. Because again, this is the airspeed that allows a minimum turning radius with no stall, no stall, and no damage. And of course, if you want to find that minimum turning radius, you just plug this back in up into this. So if you plug this velocity down here back in to there, then that will give you your minimum turning radius allowable. Okay? So just to review, this was kind of a hairy little process here. We wanted to know certain things that can happen if we have significant change in velocity across the span. So in this situation, the spanwise variation in velocity is linear. And so we found out what the inner velocity is and what the outer velocity is. And then we said that in order to preclude stall on that inner portion, we have to operate below this maximum stall limited load factor. And we, from that equation, we plugged in our stall limited load factor and we came out with an expression. Then inside that expression, we plugged in our structural load factor, structural limit, so that we could also preclude structural damage. And we came out with a quadratic equation in velocity. The positive root of this equation is then the velocity that allows a minimum turning radius with no stall and no structural damage, which can be used then to find the minimum turning radius.